Hi, everybody. Welcome to another Prog Report podcast. If you've been keeping up on new releases that are coming out this year, then you know that one of the exciting debut releases in a long time to come out is the See Within self-titled debut. Of course, that's the new supergroup featuring Roy Nastolt, Jonas Reingold, Daniel Gildenlow, Tom Breslin, Casey McPherson, and our guest today, the incredible drummer Marco Minnemann. Marco, how you doing?
I am very, very well. Thanks for calling.
Good. So how have you been? What's been going on? I know you've been doing a lot of traveling. Are you back at home now and taking some time?
Yeah. You know, I mean, I just got back from Japan. I did like a few things there and had a few shows, like a drum camp, and then also a few clinics and also two shows with friends of mine. So we did a trio. And that was that. And now I'm here recording my ass off for multiple things. It's kind of one of these things. When I'm off the road for a few weeks, then people seem to find out about it. And then I get like a lot of calls and requests for like, hey, can you do this production? Can you do that production? And can you do this? And I go like, well, you know, yeah, you know, I have my drums always set up here and ready, so I can just, you know, just on the fly record and send files out. So it's like a very comfortable way of working
right for
me, and a very easy way to make money too.
Well, that's good these days. You're one of the lucky ones, I guess. You know, I wanted to ask you, that's a good way to segue to a question that, you know, you've been doing this for a long time now, but when did you start to see that you were becoming this high in demand, you know, studio musician or guy that was getting a lot of calls? I mean, your reputation must have started to build somehow. When did that start to happen?
Oh, well, you know, I don't know. You know, I cannot really define a point there. It's kind of, you know, strange because I always did music, and one thing led to the other, isn't it? You kind of, you know, make yourself a name. You play on one album, then you play on another album, then all of a sudden people hear of the other album you played on, and so
right.
on and so forth, and it starts like an avalanche, you know, and it's a good thing, you know. And then when they hear you on different productions, if you play like, you know, let's say like a complicated, like, or a complex, like prog rock or jazz or classical production, but then you also deliver some pop productions, then people kind of all of a sudden go like, oh, cool, he's an all-rounder, we can kind of hire him for everything or something, you know. That is like when it really started, I guess, you know. It was really, but you know, I guess in the 90s, that's when it already started, when I got hired by some major bands, you know, who were actually signed in Europe, you know, by BMG or something like that. And then that was the European thing. And then I started kind of doing studio work over there, and I played pretty much with the most known names over there.
Yeah.
And then over here, actually, it started with Paul Gilbert, who I did a tour with in the late 90s. And then Mike Keneally, and then it led to other things. And then I played like a death metal band, like Necrophages and Creator.
I didn't know that one.
You know,
that's funny.
You know, oh yeah, fully. Yeah, I'm fully metal. You know, like I played a lot of metal productions and still do. And then Eddie Jobson came out of the woodworks, you know, all of a sudden, and I remembered him. So we started touring with that guy. Then Joe Satriani, now Alex Lifeson, and you know. It's kind of a thing, you know, so I cannot really pinpoint when exactly it started. It's not like, you know, that you go like, you know, whoops, now I'm in the studio world, you
right,
know,
right, right.
Now I'm in demand. It's like, you know, you kind of all of a sudden look in your selected discography online, or when people point it out, and you go like, holy shit.
You've done a lot of albums. So again, so now you're in the prog rock world again, with the Sea Within, which is you know why we're talking, and that album comes out June 22nd. For while we're talking, that's in a couple of days, and you know. So when did you get the call for that? Who called you? How did you get involved?
Yeah, that was a thing that happened with already years ago. It started, I think, like about like seven or yeah, about like yeah, 6 years ago, six, 7 years ago, with Jonas, and he called me if I wanted to partake in playing on the new Flower Kings album. And I was on the road by that time with Stephen Wilson, and then also with my own band, the Aristocrats, and I just didn't have the time. And so, you know, we had to postpone that or put it on ice, but we kept it in mind, you know. And last year, he called me again and said, like, hey, I think, you know, there is a... there's room in the world for one more supergroup, you know. how about, you know, I think that's what he literally wrote me. And I go like, what? He goes like, let's follow up on this. And I was like, you know what, why not? Because I was just going to India and for another tour, actually, and this time with my own band. And it was cool. It was like the perfect combination, you know, because we booked a studio then in London, and it all fell into place. You know, I thought, man, you know what? I can combine this. That's great. Let's all, you know, write on songs and then see how the chemistry flows in the studio together.
Yeah, so it's clear on the album credits that everybody writes on this album, which is not always the case with these bands. And so was that something that was understood from the beginning? Did you say, hey, I want to write? Or was it, hey, let's all do it? I mean, how did that come about?
Yeah, that was actually a you know, an open statement, you know, right from the get-go, you know, from Reune and also from Jonas, you know, when they, you know, started reaching out to me, going like, hey, any ideas you have, you know, please send them over, blah, 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 let's get everything together. So like, well, yeah, I have multiple songs, you know, so absolutely. So we started sending stuff around and then picked the ones we wanted to work on first. And I mean, we had more material that we could work on. There were like some songs, you know, that completely went under the radar, and maybe, you know, there will be a see within part two, you know, so you never know. Then we kind of, you know, start working on more tracks, you know. But yes, that was the thing. Everybody brought songs to the table, and I was very conscious about what I would bring to the table, because here's a funny bit. I am actually not really a prog guy. That's the funniest thing. My roots are completely somewhere different. I mean, a lot of prog bands book me, but I never really listened, you know, to much music like that. You know, I'm coming from, you know, my favorite bands are Queen, then Led Zeppelin, Kraftwerk, and then also, like, you know, the whole metal scene. You know, I was totally, you know, anchored in that. And then also, of course, Frank Zappa or Ryuichi Sakamoto or Kate Bush, those kind of things, right?
Yeah.
So I was never, and I have to completely openly admit it, I don't think I know a single Yes album or something. Maybe the ones with Trevor Rabin, I like those actually better than the older ones, you know. So people, I know for a lot of the prog fans, I guess that would be a crime.
You better be careful. They might kick you out of the prog world now that they know this.
Right. I know, you know. So it was the funniest thing, you know. And I mean, I do like Justice for Tal, but they're not really a prog band. They're like, you know, more like folk or something, you know. Other than that, like, you know, Public Image Limited or stuff like that. I like that kind of stuff. So when I brought like songs to the table, I had them more actually in the rock world, you know, and I thought it was important, you know, to have like a few up-tempo songs or like a little bit part of that. And I guess Daniel actually brought a little bit of that vibe too, so that we have like a good palette, you know. Yeah. I think a lot of beautiful material overall.
Yeah, it's a really diverse album. It there's a lot of different styles and, you know, shorter songs, longer songs, there's saxophone solos. It's all very much all over the place. With so many guys that can play, with the ability that you guys have and the ideas that come, and everybody has a million ideas, at what point, or did it ever happen where you're playing and you're going through a song and somebody says, okay, maybe that's too much, you know, maybe we should hold back here, the song's getting a little out of hand?
Oh yeah, absolutely. That happens, you know, a lot in the studio, you know, when we start playing and then we jam around on the part or something. But I guess, you know, we're all, you know, I guess pretty much experienced and musically wise enough, you know, that we don't have to let out the fireworks all the time, you know. So we kind of know when to overplay and when to hold back. And, but, you know, there are also like certain songs, you know, and like you said correctly, you know, certain songs are just kind of straightforward and they should be straightforward. And then there are certain sections, you know, where you can see, like, people would also expect us to deliver fireworks, you know.
Right.
That's part of the audience we entertain, right? But obviously, when you have a song like Goodbye, and you play a drum part or any part, you just kind of, you know, just support the song and the beauty of the song. So, you know.
So where'd the riff from Goodbye come about? That's one of the memorable moments of the album for me. Who wrote that opening part?
Man, you know what? I actually don't remember, to be very honest, because what we did, because we all brought, you know, these things into the studio, and then we started working on them in the studio, playing them as a live band, and some some stuff, you know, just got rearranged, you know, as we
it just happens. Yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, that was like, you know, one question that I had earlier in the interview where the guy goes like, Edward was like going like, hey, at the end of Goodbye, there's always there's all of a sudden this surprise hit on the drums. So, and I thought it was cool. It was like very surprising. And what was the meaning behind it? I was like, oh, really? There is a hit on the drums? I didn't even know. I was like, we must have forgotten, you know, to turn off, you know, or we just left the tail end, I guess, and found it funny. And, you know, and all of a sudden it was there, you know.
Right.
Kept it.
No, I know what he's talking
sometimes
about.
Sometimes how these things happen.
One of the song that you wrote by yourself was An Eye for an Eye for an Eye. Was that something that you had previously that maybe you just hadn't recorded?
Yes, exactly. That was a thing that was an outtake from one of my solo albums. And I didn't think that the song... that was strange, you know, that it ended up on this album, because how I usually write, I write a bunch of songs, and then the ones, you know, that are, well, good for a solo album, I'll put them on my solo album. Then there are some of the songs where I think like, oh, you know what, that could fit for the Aristocrat, and then I bring it to that table. And that Eye for an Eye song was, you know, I didn't know what to do with it. I sort of liked the riff, but it didn't fit into any of my projects. But I sort of liked the song, but I thought like, this could be a cool band setting where we can just kind of, you know, do something with it and have like, you know, and mess around. And I thought, and that was the perfect setting. I thought, this is cool. This is an up-tempo song. And it has more of a rock vibe. It kind of, you know, kicks some ass. And I thought, yeah, I'll bring that for this band, you know, in. And, well, here we are.
Yeah, no, hey, it's a great fit. Yeah. So I also want to ask you about Casey McPherson coming on board. Did he come on sort of at the end and to sing a couple of songs? And then now I guess he's going to be... in the live shows, he's going to be the main singer because Daniel's not available, right? So how did he come around?
Yeah, that was exactly what you said. You just basically answered the question.
I'm asking, yeah, you know, my questions are too long, I think.
No. The thing is, like, you know, that was exactly what that was. So first of all, we had, like, actually Daniel as a singer, and Jordan Rudess was planned as a keyboard player. And then Tom came around, actually, and it was like a whole different thing because there were like definitely scheduling problems, and we all had to find out who's available. And Tom was a great fit, and we all of a sudden was like, oh yeah, you know what, this guy is great. So Jordan plays actually, I think a guest song or something like that, you know. But yeah, so it's kind of funny. It was first of all scheduling, you know, things. Jordan went on tour with Dream Theater, I guess. You know, he was unavailable. Then Tom came in, then Daniel was available for the recordings, but not for the touring. And and then Casey came in. So that is the one thing which is kind of, yeah, sometimes, you know, a little weird, obviously, because, you know, you want to go out on tour with the same lineup. And I guess, you know, for the first show, for the Lorelei Fest, Jonas is not available because he's touring with Steve Hackett.
Right.
So it's a bit crazy, isn't it, you know?
You guys are all so busy. I mean, this is the problem. Everybody books a million projects, and then everybody's too busy.
Yeah.
This is what's going on.
It really is.
Yeah, that's funny. So I want to ask you about some of the other stuff you got going on. You know, the Aristocrats have been, I guess, on a little bit of a break. What, band coming back together soon, new music, what's going on there?
Yeah, the Aristocrats, we have been on a little hiatus, you know, because, again, scheduling stuff, you know, lots of things going on with each of our own, scheduling, you know. For example, Hans Zimmer for Guthrie, then, you know, Joe Satriani for Brian and myself, then I did... doing something with Alex Lifeson, the new album. So, yeah, these things kind of, you know, put the Aristocrats on a little break, which was actually kind of important, too, because we were touring our asses off. We were touring kind of nonstop for a consecutive, like, 6 years. And you know, and I guess, you know, we needed that break. But we're coming back together, which is kind of funny because, actually, we just toured last year, so it's fine.
Right.
Yeah, so it's actually... So, but now we're going to do a tour actually in September till October. And then I hope we start writing new music, you know, for the forthcoming album.
God, I love the Aristocrats. You guys are fantastic. Just amazing.
Oh, thank you.
Amazing live band. What's up with that Alex Lifeson album, I guess, that you're talking about? What can you tell us about that?
Well, you know, Alex has been playing already on my last album, which is called Borrego, and he came up with great ideas. I just love, how his textures are and how his tones are and, you know, what he just brings to the songs, just like the ideas. I've always loved his playing. And now we started to do a thing together. Well, again, you know, like me as the main songwriter so far, but I would love to have, you know, some of his songs actually as well. And he writes songs, obviously, and I already played a few of his songs and we recorded a bunch of them. So I hope that we somehow can, you know, form like a music collective. Like there's this one song I wrote, which is called Lover's Calling, and Mohini Day is on bass, Alex is on guitar, and well, I play the rest, and we have like, you know, Maya Nguyen, which is like, you know, she's a great singer. And so, yeah, that came together very, very nicely, you know. But again, you know, that we won't see, you know, until, you know, a few months ahead or something like that, because first of all, I obviously like to concentrate on the See Within release and then the Aristocrats kind of stuff, you know, so that we don't overwhelm the audiences.
right. I want to ask you about Satriani. Are you going to be continuing with him as well at some point?
Maybe. You never know, you know. I mean, see, with Joe, it's like a thing. I've been playing with him for, 4 years or something like that. Yeah. And he also played on my last record together with Alex, which was fantastic. But yeah, I think, you know, we sort of have other plans. You know, he's going, I think he is on the road again. He did like an album with, my God, who was it? I guess Glenn Hughes and Chet Smith. And, right. But he goes on the road also with a different band right now because he's, because the other guys are not available. See, with Joe, it's like, you know, it's the same thing what you have with the See Within right now, isn't it? You know, like always scheduling things and, as you know, like with Joe, he goes through many lineups. There's always like, he always loves to try new things and kind of, you know, do stuff. But you never know. Maybe we find each other again and do more things in the future. You know, it's one of, yeah, I don't
just
I don't
sort
know
of an
say,
open,
you know,
yeah, no, I get it. And then you also have coming up next year, you'll be with the See Within on the Cruise to the Edge. Have you done one of those cruises before?
Never. No, never. I'm actually curious, you know, to do it just because it's a cruise. I like that. You know, just the concept is great, you know.
Well, have you been on a cruise just like as a vacation before or also no?
Oh, yeah. No, I have done that, you know, just traveling from, you know, like when you tour or something, you sometimes just go from Finland to Stockholm or Denmark to somewhere, you know, these kind of things, you know. Yeah, we're doing that. But no, I never played those cruises. You know, I remember like, you know, a few years ago when we were touring, we would always make fun of that. You know, when we were touring with Stephen Wilson, like, playing the cruises or with the Aristocrats, it was like more like a bad thing to do. It was like, nah, let's not do that. But then all of a sudden people started reporting back, you know, that it's actually really fun and really awesome. And it became a cool thing to do.
It is. I've been on a few of them. It's a good time. I think you'll enjoy it. It's fun. It is fun.
There you go. Yeah. There you go. And that's why we said yes, and I wanted to kind of do it too. So
that's cool.
That's
plus,
awesome. Okay.
Plus the name, See Within, Cruise to the Edge, it makes...
Right? See Within, there you go. That's
makes true. Perfect sense. Thanks again for giving me a few minutes. Always fun to talk to you, and congrats on the album.
Thank you so much, you know, and thanks for all your scheduling and all this. It's very, very comfortable and very cool. And, see you soon somewhere.
All right, man. Take it easy. Thank you. Bye.
All right. Cheers, man. Bye.
Thanks to Marco for the interview. You can pick up the new album by The See Within out June 22nd, available everywhere. We're going to play the second single off that album. This is Goodbye. For upcoming news and interviews, please check theprogreport.com. Follow us on Facebook, at theprogreport on Twitter. Download the podcast on iTunes, Google Play, Podbean, and also on YouTube. Thanks. Oh,
bottom, looking for graves. I'm the intruder where I once was king. All that I bring now, heartache and sadness. Time to say goodbye. Time to say goodbye. Where am I going? Do I want to know? Communication breaks down and grows. Ride in the jet stream, stand by and ground. Silence of children, it's a deafening sound. Life in the absence of light, in the absence of love, scares me so. Counting my life.